Good afternoon. Welcome to our Thursday afternoon colloquium seminar series. It's my distinct pleasure to introduce Professor Yuzuru Takashima, one of our own in College of Optical Sciences, as our speaker today. I'm sure you're all familiar with him. He teaches some important courses in our undergraduate and graduate curriculum. I think undergraduate is lens design, so I'm sure some of you are here who have taken his course or are taking his course right now. And at the graduate level, he teaches optical design for multi-scale photonic systems. Prior to joining the University of Arizona, he was employed as a research staff by Stanford University, where he had been actively involved in the field of novel optical system design and engineering, particularly for high-density page-based and bit-based holographic data storage, and as well as nano-photonics electron beam generators. He was employed as an optical engineer at Toshiba Corporation in Japan, where he conducted research and development of ultra-precision manufacturing of optical components and products. And he received his bachelor's in physics from Kyoto University and his master's and Ph.D. in electrical engineering from Stanford University. So with that introduction, I'll invite Professor Yuzuru to talk about imaging LIDAR.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Ah, great. Thanks for introduction. I'm Yuzuru, and I know many of you guys. So then today's talk is about imaging LIDAR. So by the way, as Amy introduced me, I joined to this college 5-6 years ago, and I actually gave you a talk in Colloquium. And so today's topic is imaging LIDAR, but at that moment, my topic was this. In 2012, nano-photonics device beyond near-field applications. I have to ask myself where I'm heading from nano to imaging LIDAR. It's kind of, you know, interesting. You know, 5-6 years is a very long time. So, but now today, so I'll discuss about, or talk about imaging LIDAR. So by the way, if you ask Google and ask LIDAR, so which actually is a light detection and ranging. So we have a bunch of these pictures. Can you guys see that? You know, most of them are, you know, mapping of, for example, you know, tail lines and, you know, the building and bridges. And so this is also mapping of tail lines and such, right? And this is all about LIDARs. And as you can see, so a couple of other applications like, you know, autonomous vehicles like this. And actually hotels, maybe about that. And if also look into Google Images, see what kind of hardware in LIDAR system is used. So here is examples, okay? So just see a couple of images of hardware. Well, so we know this, right? So here's autonomous vehicles. And on top of roof, so there's a rotating LIDAR, so as well as millimeter wave radars, okay? And yeah, so this is also hardware, it's transmitter objective and the receiver and such. And so this one is, I believe, the Ferrodyne, so which is pretty active in laser range finding for autonomous vehicles. And of course, so it's a LIDAR equipped on drones. And so you know this small toy? So this is a LIDAR toy, so we can buy from toy store just paying $150 or so. It's a cool stuff, okay? So, but you might notice something. In this kind of hardware setup, so everything is rotating, okay? So on top of Google vehicle, mapping vehicles, so LIDAR is rotating, of course. So this mechanical LIDAR is rotating, and Ferrodyne LIDAR is rotating, and this one is probably for airborne applications. Well, it is rotating. So at this point, this kind of radar system, mechanical scanning is kind of mainstream. So then you might want to ask yourself, or I asked myself, well, big question is, so do we really need to rotate optics? So that's a big question. You know what? I know we have a bunch of mechanical engineers here, but, you know, mechanical motion causes failure, right? And in general, so non-moving approach is better than moving approach. So that's a big question. How do you think about it? Do we really need to rotate optics? We just have three options, right? Yes, we have to. No, we don't have to. And Well, I don't know. Right? It's pretty simple. So then, this actually talks, gives you some kind of flavor whether or not we really need to rotate optics. So then, my answer is again, you know, at this point, yes or no, it depends on applications. Okay? So we see what kind of application we can actually make that system, LIDAR system, like a non-moving LIDAR system. So keep it in mind. Here is our main theme of this talk. Now, let me briefly introduce you basics of LIDAR. So this is, there are a couple of ways to measure distance by using laser. But one of the most straightforward way is so-called time of flight, TOF, measurement. Okay? Now, so we have transmitter, okay, light source, maybe pulsed or maybe continuous, and it is modulated, okay? So then once we turn on laser source, so we're going to start stopwatch, okay? And light travels, so this case this is a pulse, and travels some distance and reflected by or scattered by object, and returning pulse is detected by detector. Okay, and stop the stopwatch and measure the time, right? And as you can see, well, time of flight is twice of distance. Why? Because now this is a round trip, right? Go and back, D divided by C. Yeah, it is pretty simple and straightforward. Good. And also, let me give you some kind of flavor. This is high school physics, by the way. And so distance resolution, okay, a speed of light is 3 times 10 to the 8 meter per second, right? 3 times 10 to the 8. So then 1 nanosecond of time, say 10 to the minus 9, so which corresponds to 0.3 meter, about this range, okay? So then round trip, so 1 nanosecond corresponds to about 0.15 meter, about this, right? So then, if you want to detect time of pulse, so how fast the detector should be? Well, so about the same time scale, nanosecond. So then detector rise time has to be about nanosecond rise time. So far, so good. Do you agree with me? Yeah? And at the same time, well, so we have to start stopwatch and we have to stop stopwatch, right? And how fast that electronics has to be? Well, gigahertz of bandwidth electronics. So this is kind of, you know, intuition, you know, how fast the detector has to be and how fast the electronics has to be to do the TOF time of flight measurement. Okay, so far so good. Now, the other thing we need to think about, so when we design optical system, so we have to understand scaling law. How system performance depends on, you know, design parameters. Next things I'd like to briefly discuss about is the following. Now, in TOF measurement, it is pretty simple in terms of scaling law. Here's a D, is a distance we're going to measure. Okay? So then, measurable distance is roughly scales with square root of these parameters. So P is the power of laser, and A is a aperture area of receiving optics, how large that, you know, receiver is. And TA and TO is the transmission of air and transmission efficiency of optics, and divided by pi, and DS is sensitivity of detector, and B is a beam divergence, right? And intuitively, what's the message? So message is pretty straightforward. If we want to measure long distance, so we have to make size of aperture large. That makes sense. Why? Because we want to collect more photons, right? Good. And so here's A and P. So this also makes sense. If we want to deliver more photons, we have to have high power laser. It's simple. and TA and TO well. So high transmission in optics is beneficial, of course. And having, you know, the sensitivity, smaller number of photons for which, for example, noise equivalent power of detector, so we can measure larger distance. And of course, if we coordinate beam more, yes, we can focus photon more effectively on the target. So therefore, we can measure long distance. Okay, here's a simple scaling law. Now, based on that, now, in terms of from the viewpoint of optical design, of optical system engineering, so this is our interest, you know, how optics look like, and what kind of detector we're going to use, and what kind of laser, sorry, also has to be also highlighted in red, but what kind of laser we're going to use, and beam divergence is also important parameter in optical design. Okay? So then, in LIDAR, so we have a couple of options. For the transmitter, this kind of pulsed laser diode, whose wavelengths span, say, 850 to 1550, is commercially available. And the peak power varies, say, a couple of watts, 3 watt, 4 watt, to, say, hundreds of watts. Okay, so then this kind of laser is also available. And photo detector, we have a couple of options. Now, pin photodiode, so most likely reverse biased, and also avalanche photodiode. So here is taken the APD taken from the Hamamatsu website. We have APD and photo multiplier tube. So these are typical components, at least in consumer segment, or autonomous vehicle laser range finding. This kind of device is commonly used. Okay? So then, if you look into, for example, this detector, right? Have you ever looked into APD? A pin photodiode? Yes? Right? Do you remember how large that detector area is? It's not that as big as, you know, centimeter, right? But typical, you know, detector size, especially for high-speed applications, the detector area or detector size is about 0.1 millimeter or less. And it's kind of rare, and detector size detector with a detector large detector size, relatively large detector size, like a millimeter, and high speed operation. So that's kind of an important factor we need to consider if we want to design LIDAR system. Also, that gives us some kind of answer whether or not we really have to rotate optics or not. We see. So then, for most of the case, the LIDAR actually employs mechanical rotation. Okay? Why? Because now, as we understand, if we want to measure very long distance, so we have to make that aperture size very large, relatively large, about this size. Okay? For example, for this ferrodine laser case. And that makes sense because, as we understand from that simple scaling law, so having larger aperture, so we have better SNR. That makes sense. Okay, but at the same time, okay, if we want to actually scan or do wide field of imaging, so we actually have two options. One is so this kind of mechanical rotation. Okay, so what else we can do? So I know a couple of students from my 340 there. Alex, what's the option to do the wide field of imaging? Well, lens. Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. So then, if we want to do the wide field of imaging, so what would you like to do? You know, use longer focal length or shorter focal length? Wide field of imaging, given the same size of detector, so focal length has to be, again, you have three options, long, short, same. Short, right? So if you look into, you know, your camera, single reflex camera, for example, you have zoom, right? Okay. And if you want to do the wide field of imaging, what would you like to do? Well, reduce focal length, right? If you want to do telephoto imaging, you have to increase focal length. Good? Okay? Now we understand that if we do the imaging, especially for LIDAR applications, we have to reduce focal length. Do you agree with me? Yes? So what's next? What's the size of aperture? So question number two, given F number, so F number is focal length divided by aperture size, right? Okay, if you reduce focal length, what's going to happen? The aperture size is also reduced, right? Okay, so then, so that's a fundamental problem of imaging LIDAR system. Well, so then given size of detector is kind of limited. Why? Because now we have to operate detector very fast in gigahertz range. To do so, size of detector as a current state of the art is about 0.1 millimeter or so. It's extremely small. Okay? So then we have to actually match the detector size to optics. Okay? So then it turned out if we want to do the imaging LIDAR, so we have to reduce focal length. And accordingly, aperture size is reduced. So therefore, measurable distance is also reduced. Okay? So the answer is the following. Now, if we want to do the very long range measurement, so like, you know, autonomous vehicle applications, I believe we have to still rotate optics. So that's the most, you know, reasonable way to do. But if we don't have to measure, say, distance at 100 meter, 200 meter, but, you know, say, a couple of meters, probably, so there might be a way to do the non-mechanical imaging for LIDAR. So that's a message. Well, so then, actually, so there are a couple of examples for imaging LIDAR. Well, so this is taken from SPIE newsroom. I believe this is from 2012 or so. And so there is a non-imaging LIDAR, especially for defense and airborne applications. So here's a telescope. Okay, so telescope and what's this? This is a rifle scope for alignment. Yeah. So then I believe, so this one is a transmitter and here's an object and this telescope actually receives light and do the TOF measurement. And the detector, which is not a single detector like this kind of APD, but in commercially available, there's a commercially available detector, so array of avalanche photodiode, so something like this. This picture is taken from the Princeton Lightwave, I forgot, the company in New Jersey, and they are making array of APD arrays. So for example, 32 by 32 APD arrays, and the size of imaging area is about 3.2 by 3.2 millimeter, and still the size of detector area of each individual APD is 0.1 millimeter. But so this one is pretty amazing detector. For example, now 186 kilo frame per second, and it can capture image extremely fast. So then by using this kind of high-speed and high-end APD array detector, well, so we do the imaging LIDAR as was proven by Robert Lam. But you know, how about consumer market? For this example, probably he measured 1 kilometer of distance and magnified object, here's a tree. And suddenly this APD detector array works in a time of flight measurement. And here is a map of distance. Wow. Resolution range is a couple of meters. So which is amazing. Okay. But how about consumer market? So then specifically, I'm interested in how LIDAR in non-imaging optical configuration, non-moving part of the configuration, how can we apply that kind of technology? Well, so I did a little bit of market research with help from Amy Phillips, TLA. So now, here is the application and market size, of especially in consumer segment for LIDARs. And how can we read this? Well, so vertical axis is a measurement range, distance. Okay? So then horizontal axis is field of view, FOV. Then, so fully autonomous car applications, and apparently, so we have to measure relatively a very long range, say 100, over 100 meter range. Okay? And as opposed to this kind of long range measurement applications, so there certainly is a market for small range applications, say, about meters. For example, gesture recognition. Have you ever looked into Microsoft Kinect? Right? And Microsoft Kinect can suddenly recognize hand gesture and control PC or software and such. Okay? So then, for that kind of gesture, hand gesture recognition and touch sensing, so you don't have to measure 100 meters, but just in a couple of meters of range finding with so relatively small FOV, say 30 to 60 degrees, is okay. Well, so in between, so there is a very interesting segment, so which actually is range finding range is not that long, not 100 meter, but say 3 to 5 meter or up to 10 meter. And field of view is kind of wide, say 100 degrees or 120 degrees. So then it turned out this segment and service and industrial robotic application, according to some literature, so the market size is pretty large. So for example, autonomous shopping cart, suppose you go to shopping to Safeway and put a bunch of groceries in your shopping cart, right? And push button, and shopping cart actually autonomously takes shopping groceries to your car, for example, in a parking lot. And same thing for the material handling. in factory, so we have to handle a bunch of the components and the parts. So then material handling is also kind of big the market for this kind of autonomous cart system. And construction safety and wheelchairs, robotics. So then if you look into existing components or hardwares again, this one is a rotating LIDAR. And so for the robotics, still, they use rotating mechanical scanner. Okay? And for this gesture recognition application, there are a couple of interesting systems, including Kinect and also TOF measurement sensor, either from this company from Germany or Hamamatsu. So then this field is also active. So then what else we can do? Well, now I'm thinking that what else we can do, for example, especially for short or mid-range range finding and relatively wide FOV, and by using, say, commercially available components like a detector and laser. And here is one possible way, and we are working on that. Now, sorry. So what we are working on is DMD-based and mid-range imaging LIDAR. So how it works? Well, we have transmitter, so which is laser diode, okay? And we're going to illuminate object by this transmitter. Okay, here's an illumination object, okay? So now object reflects back the incoming light towards optics, okay? And the optics, we have DMD. So now this optics is now like a wide field of view imaging system. And the optics images this object right on the DMD. Okay? So then by actually selectively turning on and off DMD, so we actually just use single detector to detect object location and distance. So this one, I believe you guys are familiar with that. Basically, it's a projector. So now suppose instead of detector, if we have a light source, okay? So light source illuminates DMD. And on DMD, we project, say, my presentation, and here's a screen. So then we do kind of the other way to projector to detect distance as well as location of the object. And how it works? Well, let me repeat what we are doing. Now, so we have DMD. And suppose we have two objects, object A and object B. Okay? So object A is there and object B is there. Then if we want to detect object A, so they just turn on DMD like this. So left-hand side is turned on, while right-hand side is turned off. And if we want to detect object B, so we actually flip the pattern. And by sequentially changing the pattern of DMD, so we do the spatial scanning while employing TOF measurement. So here's the basic idea. Okay? Any questions? So far, so good? Okay? And optics is like this. So then let me briefly explain electronics. So here's a block diagram of electronics. The core part is microcontroller, Arduino. Have you ever worked on that Arduino? Yeah, $60 from Amazon. It's cool. Okay? So Arduino actually turns on laser, 95 nanometer pulse laser, and we have a transmission optics, which is composed of, you know, bunch of optics and diffusers and beam shaping optics. And we have receiving optics, and along with a triggering pulse, we trigger DMD. Okay, we change, we upload the pattern on DMD. Okay, so then once signal is detected by a photodiode, now we'll amplify it by amplifier, and so we have a comparator which actually set up the threshold. And before, well, along with firing laser, so we're going to actually start timer, the stopwatch, okay? So then the start timer and pulse travels and travels back and detected by DMD and photodiode gets amplified, and we have some threshold. And once the signal approaches certain thresholds, we're going to stopwatch, okay? So then, by using this setup, we actually measure time of distance, time of TOF, time of travel, okay? And while changing DMD patterns. So here's how it works. Good? And the message here is the following. Now, it's not that, you know, specially designed hardware, but from Amazon, we buy Arduino, $60, and buy a bunch of ICs, and we can suddenly make nice TOF setup. Okay? So then, what's the benefit? Well, as we understand from this optical architecture and TOF measurement architecture, so now we can do imaging and range finding at the same time, simultaneously. Okay? And also, by using optics, the FOB is wide, relatively wide, say 70 degrees horizontally, and we show you how it looks like, okay, and 10 degrees vertically. And so this is a wavelength independent system. Why? Because now DMD is a passive device. Well, we can use 580 or 1550, or if we need to use, say, CO2 laser 10 micron, it should work too. Okay, so which is a great benefit. And what else? Well, so this system employs imaging system, right? Now, suppose you do zooming, okay? So we can suddenly change the field of view adaptively. And also, you guys know how digital zoom works in your iPhone, right? So given fixed focal lengths, you can actually digitally zoom up and zoom down, zoom in and zoom out, right? So digital zoom is also possible. And as we found, so this system has a relatively low BOM, bill of materials. Why? Because now we can buy, for example, Pico projector, so which has DMD, say, on eBay, so a couple of $100. So bill of materials, relatively low. And so this is almost non-moving part system, except for micrometer. So here's the specifications we are trying to achieve. So then distance, you're going to measure up to 5 meter, and distance resolution is 25 millimeter, 2.5 centimeter. We want to distinguish, you know, 2.5 centimeter across 5 meter distance. And FOB 70 by 70 horizontal and 10 vertical. And angular resolution is 0.5 degree by 0.5 degree. It's relatively small, small angular resolution. And MATLAB, we're going to use eye-safe laser and system dimension. Still, this is in a benchtop system about this size. Okay? And let me show you an example. So here's an actual distance image taken by our system. Okay? Now, you see bottle here, and a you know, couple of optical mount here. And here is a field of view. The horizontal FOB is 75 degrees, and vertical FOB is 10 degrees. Okay. So here is how image looks like. You see, so this hardware here, and here's a lens mount, and so this line is a bottle. Okay. And so here's another image, hand. See, so I think, so this is maybe Brandon's hand. And you can suddenly see image hand by using system-wide measurement distance. Okay, so here is how the image looks like. And so another example is, so this one. So here's a random target. So we have a couple of different, you know, targets, like a high reflectivity target, and the low or middle moderate reflectivity target, and which is actually placed kind of randomly. Okay, and here's the image taken by our system. You see which one is which. So this one is there, and so which one is which. So this one, there's occlusion here, right? So they are overlapping there. So I think these are two images, and small one is here and there, and such. Okay. Here is how image looks like. Well, so we are also doing some kind of distance measure performance test. And for example, so this is actual resolution test. Now we have three targets, okay? And we can actually measure or move the central target back and forth. And let me show how it looks like. So then, oh, sorry. Now, so here is, I believe, all the three targets are the same distance, at the same distance. And move the central one closer, see the difference in color. See, so here's like a bluish, closer, getting closer, and closer, like that. Okay? So it's kind of interesting. Okay, and we are also doing another kind of test. Oh, this is a distance resolution test. Okay, now here is how accurate that measurement is. For example, now if we measure distance, so as a function of actual distance, the horizontal axis is actual distance. We know the distance. Okay, so then vertical axis is a measured distance by the system. And ideally, so then measured distance has to be uniquely or one-to-one relationship between a measured and the actual distance has to have, right? The slope is one, okay? Its slope is one. But depending on the number of averaging we employ, so then resolution actually improves. Now, if we just do one pulse, just use one single pulse, the currently, so this is not the final result, but currently the resolution, distance resolution is about 10 centimeter. And if we do, you know, 10 times of averaging of pulse, well, suddenly we can improve that, you know, close to the spec. So here's a short range result, up to 2 meter. And also, so here is a long-range measurement result. So we can suddenly measure distance up to 5 meters. And again, so here is a result, resolution as a function of number of averages, you know, kind of 5 to 7 centimeters. So this is what we have so far achieved by using our hardware. Okay? And also let me show you another kind of test. So here's an angular resolution test. Well, so what we did is the following. Now, again, we have three test targets, so which is placed side by side. And we can actually gradually increase spacing among three targets like this. Okay, so here is zero spacing. And we have a little bit of spacing corresponds to 0.5 degrees. And 1 degree, yeah, we can certainly resolve that. And 1.5 degree, yes, clearly resolved. Okay. So now this test gives us some kind of intuition in how fine we can resolve in space domain. Okay. So then here's the fun part. And we actually captured a movie, how it looked like. Now, we have a cube, it's a box, okay, and which is suspended by rope, and we actually move cube like this, and capture image by using our setup. So here's how it looks like. See, can you imagine that? The object is rotating like this. Sorry, this is not the movie, but you see, so here is an object which is actually suspended by a wire, and we rotate and capture image like this. So then, what's the message? Well, the message is the following. Now, this system has a relatively fast frame rate, so which is 5.6 FPS, so 5 to 6 frames per second, so which is not that bad. So if you look into, for example, ferrodyne rotating system, and the typical frame rate is, for example, 10 FPS. So then LIDAR system rotates 10 times per second. Okay. Now this system can capture, you know, close to 5.6 frames per second. Okay. So here is a summary of result. Well, you know, this kind of non-moving part, imaging LIDAR suddenly works for mid-range measurement. And actually, our team achieved about, you know, measurement distance up to 7. Okay, so we are still working on improved maximum measurement distance. But so this is kind of flavor. Okay, and so distance resolution at this point, now it is about 5 centimeters. But we also identified that is due to the jitter of timing circuit of Arduino, 60 bucks. And we are trying to replace Arduino with FPGA circuit to improve this, you know, jitter, or to reduce jitter and to improve accuracy of measurement. Well, field of view 70 by 10, so which is great. And angular resolution 0.5, this is also good. And frame rate, I'm glad, so we can capture a movie. Okay. And so for this demonstration, so we used iSafe 905 nanometer pulse laser. And it's a benchtop system about this size. But as you can see, so then form factor, we can drastically reduce form factor, like a Pico projector. Remember that Pico projector size is about this size. Okay. So there's no fundamental bottleneck in terms of reducing form factor. So, here is our conclusions. Now, we are working on non-moving part and imaging architecture, so which actually is specifically good for mid-range distance measurement, say up to 10 meters. And as we have proved, it works. And so there's potential market. It is huge, like, you know, service and industrial robotics. And good thing of this approach is now we can leverage consumer product, like laser diode, PD, DMD, and the MEMS scanner, and low-cost microprocessor. And good to you guys is now in this system, there are still lots of challenges in optical design and optical engineering, and it's kind of fun. So then let me introduce my co-workers. So LIDAR team is led by these three students, Braden, Brandon, and Andre, and Yosik is here. And these guys did a tremendous and fabulous job. And we had Alonzo Espinosa and Erica Bonset. So these guys actually pioneered this approach. So DMD-based imaging LIDAR system. So initially, so just the measurement point was 2. But these guys proved that now the system works. And so we got the support from TLA, Amy Phillips. Thank you very much for your help. And hope we can license this technology to a company or, you know, some industrial entity to continue this effort. And thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any questions, you know me, right? So this is me, Yuzuru. Thank you very much.